Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The History of Physics, A Very Short Introduction, by J.L. Heilbron, narrated by Sean Runnette. Introduction. The Greek Way. The Superconducting Supercollider, SSC, the dream of American high-energy physicists, would have had a circumference of 87 kilometers and a price tag to match. Its proponents justified the expenditure on several grounds. On the high ground, it would probe the universe to philosophical depths and thus keep faith with the Greeks. Below ground, it would advance tunneling technique and give society perfect sewers. Congress canceled it in 1993. The undertaking represented by the SSC might be the way to an ultimate physics, but it is not the Greek way. In antiquity, physics was philosophy, a liberal art, the pursuit of a free man wealthy enough to do what he wished. He did not aim to improve sewers, and since he had no need of public money, did not have to claim that he would. Nor did he want apparatus, since he seldom experimented, or mathematics, since he seldom calculated. The few ancient applications of mathematics to physics constituted a mixed science devoted to the description of phenomena rather than to the search for principles. In the tripartite division of Greek philosophy, physics stood between logic and ethics. It inquired into the principles regulating the physical world from the high heavens to the earth's center, and from the human soul to the life of the least of living creatures. It thus functioned as a necessary approach to ethics, or the principles of a good life. For two millennia, the main practical value of physics lay in the ethical consequences of its versions of the way the world began and persists. Greek physics, with its eye to ethics, its indifference to mathematics and experiment, and its independence from states and courts, is sufficiently distinct from an enterprise conducted by salaried teams requiring elaborate technologies and mathematical analyses to deserve a different name. Let it be physica, and those who cultivated it, physici. This short book describes some of the ways by which ancient physica became modern physics. It does not ransack history to find items in ancient and medieval science that look like physics, but sketches the place and purpose of physica in the societies that supported it. Hence, the primary site or sites of cultivation receive special emphasis: the independent private school, antiquity, court and library, Islam, university, later Middle Ages, court again, Renaissance, academy, late 17th and 18th centuries, university again, modernity, and university government industry, post-modernity. Of course, successive forms did not annihilate their predecessors. Academies of science survive, primarily as honorific societies and depositories of history, although a few flourish as national channels for funding, consultation, and outreach. The scientific advisory apparatus of government may be considered the descendant of courtly science, and the Greek schools, with their characteristic discursive style, continue in the myriad seminars in which the world's nascent science is presented and anatomized. Chapter 1. Invention in Antiquity. Tradition follows Aristotle in identifying the earliest physici as some gentleman of Miletus, and in specifying half a dozen other Greek speakers as their successors. In this Philo-Hellenic creation myth, no Greek physicos learned anything from a barbarian during the 250 years between the times of the eldest Milesian, Thales, and Aristotle. The story of Pythagoras, if he existed, did so partly in Egypt, suggests outside input, and studies of cuneiform texts reveal a natural knowledge among the Babylonians in some ways more advanced than that of the ancient Greeks. Still, the essential criterion that Aristotle used to identify his predecessors was not that they were Greek, but that they had conquered a paralyzing prejudice. despite robust contrary evidence, they believed that the natural world runs on law-like principles, discoverable by the human mind and immune from interruption or cancellation by meddling gods and demons. This bold departure underlies and circumscribes all forms of physica, natural philosophy, and physics. Its implications go farther even than replacing caprice by law-like behavior. Since the gods displayed all too faithfully the behavior of human beings, de-deifying implied, to speak Greek, de-anthropomorphizing. The progress of physics has continued to remove human quirks and qualities projected onto nature. Thus, nature, or the objective world, came to lose not only benevolence, malevolence, and color, but also such apparently indispensable attributes as space, time, and causality. Of the four main schools of ancient philosophy, Aristotle's paid greatest attention to physica. Having a particular interest in zoology, he derived his fundamental principles with an eye to the classification of animals. Because of his emphasis on physica, and because his philosophy dominated during the Middle Ages and beyond, convenience advises taking it as normative. In antiquity, however, it had to compete with Platonic, Epicurean, and Stoic philosophies. Typically, a school's premises, library, and other assets passed from the founder to his senior disciples, and perhaps consequently, the schools bore names suggestive more of real estate than of scholarship. The Academy, Grove for the Platonists, Lyceum, a shrine, and Parapatos, a place for walking for the Aristotelians, the Stoa, porch, for the Stoics, and the Garden of Epicurus. During the 800 years from the founding of the Academy in Athens and its refounding in Alexandria, the four schools underwent many reversals of fortune. When operating normally, they were forums for free discussion of the sort practiced in political circles, but centered on studies pursued for personal improvement rather than for civic or financial advancement. Some students stayed with a single school for decades. Others sampled each in turn. When Romans like Cicero frequented the schools of Athens, they took advantage of this Lernfreiheit. The Pythagoreans did not form such a school, as they did not tolerate deviations from their doctrines and way of life. Physica. Although physica ran from astronomy through zoology to psychology, limitation of coverage to cosmology and cosmogony, as in this book, is not unacceptably anachronistic, provided we recognize that the same principles of structure and change applied to all natural processes. This truncated physica corresponds to the books of Aristotle dealing with general principles, physica, the heavens, de caelo, the region between the moon and the earth, meteorologica, and the creation and destruction of things on or in the earth, de generatione et corruptione. These books, and the rest of the corpus from logic to ethics, became available in a standard format edited around 60 BCE from the lecture notes Aristotle bequeathed to his successors. They constitute the main parts of a theory of everything, or as the moderns say, a toe. The first toes Aristotle stepped on belonged to the Milesian monists. He then took on more generous materialists, Leucippus and Democritus, who allowed two principles, atoms and the void. Empedocles, who accepted the three Milesian elements, water, air, fire, and added earth, to complete the tetrad, and Anaxagoras, who admitted an infinite number of different sorts of stuff. There were also those whose matter had no stuff at all, Pythagoras, notably, for whom number had an independent existence. The Pythagoreans' deduction that there must be a counter-earth circulating opposite ours around a central fire to raise the number of heavenly bodies to the holy tetractus proved to Aristotle both the falsity of their physica and the nonsense to which numbers can lead. Aristotle's teacher, Plato, inclined towards numerology. He took as his material not only mathematical abstractions, but also supersensible idealizations of classes of objects. For example, the idea horse in which individual horses participate, more or less, but always imperfectly. Consequently, although Plato was optimistic about the possibility of knowing the ideal world and the supreme good that made the ideas and their relations intelligible, he did not allow the possibility of true knowledge of the things of this world. Since no material individual could express an idea perfectly, our physica can never be other than fuzzy. Physica comes from physis, meaning nature, which, according to Aristotle, is the source or cause of being moved or being at rest. What makes things move? The early physici adumbrated four causes of change that Aristotle later codified. The monists and the atomists considered only the material cause. Empedocles and Anaxagoras provided action by taking some principles to be active and others passive, vague glimpses of efficient causes. Others saw the need to explain order in a universe of change and hinted at a teleological or final cause, such as set by a cosmic mind. And Plato supplied a fourth cause, the formal, the idea in which a thing participates. Aristotle's inventory of the cosmological ideas of his predecessors, including anticipations of the four causes of change, was not an idle retrospective. It confirmed that he had not overlooked anything fundamental. Of all who have discussed principles and causes, none has spoken of any kind except those which have been distinguished in my discourses on physics. Aristotle's toe, thus established as complete, makes use of some special concepts. A substance is any individual thing. The collection of its properties constitutes its form, which, contrary to a Platonic idea, occurs only in union with matter. Form can be divided, although only mentally, into essence, which makes a substance the sort of thing it is, and accidents, which can change without causing the substance to alter its essence or kind. The essences of the four elements are easily stated. Fire is dry, hot, and absolutely light. Air is hot, moist, and relatively light. Water is cold, moist, and relatively heavy. Earth is cold, dry, and absolutely heavy. The elements can transform into one another as fire evaporates water into air. Socrates may be warm or cold, but heated or cooled too much, and he will cease to be Socrates. It may now be intelligible to state that a substance's matter and essence are its material and formal causes, and that the active qualities of hotness and moistness are the principal efficient causes of change. The final cause is the purpose for the existence of a form. Heavy bodies have gravity so as to fall towards the center of the world, and light bodies have levity so as to rise towards the heavens, thus restoring order disrupted by the activity of animate creatures or the revolutions of the celestial spheres. These spheres, and the stars and planets they carry, cannot be made of the four elements, whose forms require that they move when unimpeded in a straight line towards or away from the world's center. A fifth element, a quintessence, obeying its formal and final causes, circulates around the universal center. With these few principles and some ad hoc adjustments, Aristotle worked his way from the mind of the unmoved mover, which, as it can think only of the most sublime thing, can think only of itself, down to the mind of man, which, though no less self-centered than the mind of the universe, is changeable like everything else below the quintessential heavens, and where there is change, there cannot be certainty. The best a physicus can do is to find a rule that applies to what is always true, or true for the most part. A few deductions from Aristotle's approximate physica that came under sustained scrutiny will give some impression of its general character. Every motion, whether change of place or color or species, requires an external mover. In a vacuum, there literally is no place, no reference material, by which a body can orient itself. Hence, there can be no vacuum. The flight of an arrow implies a vortex in the air, which cedes a place to the tip while pushing in at the tail. The ambiguous role of the air, offering both resistance and propulsion, made an obvious difficulty. Another awkwardness arose from the absolute dichotomy between terrestrial and celestial physics. Because the heavens cannot change, transient phenomena that appear to take place there, like comets and meteors, must have their seat with lightning and the weather in sublunar regions. Nothing, however, is more obvious than that the sun influences the weather. How? Sometimes Aristotle wrote as if he thought that the sun was hot, which would violate his proscription against terrestrial qualities in heaven. More often, he ascribed the seasonal powers of the sun to its annual revolution, which, together with the rolling of the quintessential spheres, continually stirs up the sublunary regions. These disturbances cause moist and dry vapors to rise from the earth. Precipitation results from the moist exhalation, winds from the dry. The same stuff is wind on earth and earthquakes under it, and in the clouds, thunder. Lightning and thunder are dry exhalations breaking free from the clouds. The rainbow is a reflection from the clouds. Aristotle uncharacteristically described it geometrically. The sun, the eye of the observer, and the center of the bow lie on a straight line that cannot exceed a certain angle with the horizon. This factoid would have a long and influential history. Despite the continuing operation of final causes, the world is not in perfect order. The frictional drag of the turning lunar sphere on the stationary region of fire below it produces such anomalies as fiery meteors in the air, mountains above sea level, and water below Earth. In the big picture, however, the universe resembles an onion. Peeled from the outside in, it discloses the fixed stars, the planets and luminaries in the conventional order Saturn, Jupiter, Mars, Sun, Venus, Mercury, and Moon, and in slight disorder, the elements fire, air, water, and earth. What is outside the skin? Here the onion analogy fails. There is literally nothing there. And just as there is no space not included in the visible universe, there was no time at which it did not exist. Aristotle's world picture thus lacked a creator. So did the atomic theory of Democritus, who nevertheless offered a creation story for the visible universe. It began to be when some atoms, bouncing about in the infinite void, chanced to form a great vortex. The largest fell to the center, forming the Earth. From what remained, centrifugation produced the air, the luminaries, the planets, and the stars. Although the same dull stuff makes up everything, our sensory systems can build rich images from its few properties, the size, shape, and motion of its constituent atoms. Epicurus added a spontaneous swerve to explain how atoms, falling in parallel through the void, occasionally collide and concatenate a world. According to him, the soul can exploit this swerve to choose to live the good life in an otherwise pointless universe. Since the Epicurean did not have to fear gods in this life or anything in the next, he could take moderate enjoyment of the flesh and free employment of the mind as the greatest goods. The inevitable erosion of all sound doctrine has transformed Epicurus's sober happiness into selfish hedonism. Whereas the atomists allowed for the creation of many worlds in space and time by random accretion of their parts, the Stoics supposed that the single cosmos they admitted, geocentric like Aristotle's, is alternately destroyed and recreated. In place of disparate atoms, the Stoics put a continuous prime matter, and in place of bumps and grinds, pneuma, a self-moving, elastic compound of fire and air that gives matter its cohesive and other properties. Strict causality applies everywhere, guaranteed and affected by the spatial continuity of the pneuma. The system would seem to rule out free will decisively. But since ethics required a free acceptance of fate and the mental preparation necessary to meet it, Stoics had to find a way around the strict causality of their physics. Their solution was no more plausible than the Epicurean swerve. As an alternative to strict atomism, however, the Stoic concept of a space-filling, active, elastic spirit had a future. In contrast to the peripatetics with their unchanging, uncreated cosmos, and the atomists and stoics with their random and cyclical worlds, the academics had a full cosmogony, with a creator as well as a creation story. As told by Plato's mouthpiece, the mathematician Timaeus of Locris, the demiurge who made the realm of ideas used what he had left after rolling out the celestial equator and the paths of the planets to manufacture human souls. These he sent to stars in the realm of ideas to await planting in bodies created by the lesser gods to whom he assigned the task of making the sensible world. At the end of life, the rational soul returns to its star if the human possessor has lived a good life. If not, the soul reincarnates in a lesser being. Our animal parts serve merely to keep our head, the seat of our reason, from rolling around on the ground. Used properly, our rational soul can bring us, via observation of the motions of the heavenly bodies, to the discovery of number, time, and harmony, and to the contemplation of the ideas. We might then perceive that the ideas of the four elements and the quintessence are linked to the mathematics of the five regular solids. The plane faces of the three of them, the tetra, octa, and icosahedron, are equilateral triangles, and consequently the elements corresponding to them, fire, air, and water, are incontrovertible. The remaining two, the cube and the dodecahedron, are the ideas of the earth and the universe as a whole. We should not press the obvious difficulties. The lesser gods who created the material world were not entirely competent. It is fitting that we should, in these matters, accept the likely story and look for nothing further. Roman worlds. Although foreign students from Rome added little of note to Greek physica, they turned much of it into useful summaries and compendia. During the last years of the Republic, Lucretius versified Epicurus's atomism. During the reign of Caesar Augustus, the poet Ovid made a conspicuous place for Pythagoreanism in his Metamorphoses. Under the Emperor Nero, Seneca composed a meteorology on Stoic principles, cut short, unfortunately, by Nero's invitation, which Seneca could scarcely refuse, to commit suicide. And in the years before his fatal inspection of Vesuvius, during its eruption of 79 CE, Pliny the Elder crammed into one of the 37 books of his Natural History a qualitative survey of the world, featuring a god unpolluted by commerce with human beings, a naturalistic account of meteors, comets, and eclipses calculated to free humankind from fear of lesser gods, some hints at atomism and stoicism, physica of chance and necessity, and a few bars from Pythagorean music of the spheres. Lucretius begins his poem with the customary invocation of a muse, in this case Venus, after which he disobligingly announces that his great purpose is to remove her and all the other gods from human concerns. The atoms, cavorting in the infinite void, follow the laws of necessity apart from the occasional, unintelligible swerve that gives spontaneity to the world and freedom to the will. No external agency can interfere with this process. Though thou be nothing but a chance congeries of buzzing particles, be joyful, submit to fate, and fear not the impotent gods. The exposition of Pythagorean doctrine that Ovid jams into his catalogue of beings that transform into beasts treats only briefly the founder's physica, his teachings about the great world's origin, the cause of things, what nature is, what god and whence the snow, what makes the lightning, whether thunder comes from Jove or from the winds when clouds burst wide, why the earth quakes, what ordinance controls the courses of the stars. Most of Ovid's account of Pythagorean thought concerns metempsychosis and vegetarianism, a belief and a practice indissolubly connected. If souls transmigrate, how can you tell whether your ox, your faithful brother at the plow, was not in fact your late brother? This sound teaching fell on deaf ears. Ovid admitted as much. Seneca, writing half a century later, reported that would-be Pythagoreans could not find a teacher. But that, according to Seneca, merely mirrored the sad state to which philosophy in general had fallen. Many philosophical lineages are dying out without a successor. His Natural Questions, an attempt to reinvigorate Stoic Physica, reconstructed the meteorology of the Stoa and the Lyceum to answer the questions whose solution Ovid credited to Pythagoras: the causes of the wind and weather, thunder and lightning, and earthquakes. These had been standard problems in Physica since the time of Thales. In Seneca's meteorology, high winds, thunder, and earthquakes are explosions of previously constrained pneuma. Breaking from Stoic authority, he enrolled comets, famous for bad reputations, among planets, and toyed with the possibility that their daily motions and those of the stars in general arise from a revolution of the earth rather than from the turning of the celestial vault. As his placement of comets suggests, the interconnectedness of the Stoics' space-filling active pneuma destroyed the barrier between the heavens and the earth, characteristic of Aristotelian cosmology. Seneca puffed up his meteorology with moral reflections that appear to be its reason and result. If you do not inquire into the material foundation of the world and the nature of its creator or guardian, or speculate whether he still creates, if he ever did or has retired, whether he thinks only of himself and whether he can amend fate, you enslave yourself to merely human affairs. Life would not be worth its pain and suffering were it not for the opportunity to learn that nature, fate, the world, providence, and God are different names for the same thing, that God did not make the world exclusively for human beings, that life is a sentence of death, and philosophy, by dispelling fear of death, is the only healthy way to resign oneself to fate. Seneca's eloquent combination of moralizing and meteorology made the Natural Questions the authority on the physical problems it treated for most of the Latin Middle Ages. Had Plutarch's Dialogue on the Markings of the Moon not suffered an eclipse of 15 centuries, Seneca's Stoicism would have faced a sprightly challenge in medieval times. Plutarch proposed a question that embarrassed several ancient systems. Why do we not see the sun's image on the moon as we see it on the sea? Since the answer depends on knowledge of the moon's makeup, mathematicians could not answer it. What, then, did the Physici have to say? The modeled lunar surface shows that the peripatetic model of the moon as pure quintessence is nonsense. The Stoic view that it is made of a sort of pneuma is worse, since air and fire cannot reflect visual rays. Plato's model, which gives the moon a rocky surface that acts as if composed of a great many randomly oriented mirrors, is the best option. What, then, keeps the rocky moon from falling on the earth? The rapidity of its revolution, just as missiles placed in slings are kept from falling by being whirled around in a circle. What keeps it close to earth? A literal law of nature. The position of earth lays in action against the moon, and she is legally assignable by right of propinquity and kinship to the earth's real and personal property. Is the moon inhabited? Very likely, but by creatures as different from us as we are from fish, and also by disembodied souls awaiting their next incarnation. Plutarch's ideas about the moon, minus his metempsychosis, recur in Galileo and Kepler. During the philosophical downturn mentioned by Seneca, the Platonic Academy did not exist. It had come to a temporary end during the Roman conquest of Athens in 86 BCE, after a period of intense skepticism about the possibility of achieving any secure knowledge about anything. It revived in 410 CE with a curriculum based on Neoplatonism, invented in Rome by Plotinus, who died in 270 CE, and systematized by his disciple, Porphyry. Plotinus was not a skeptic. His confident speculations rose above even the demiurge, whose employment as creator, even if only of the rational realm and the lesser gods, seemed to him incompatible with occupying the acme of the divine pyramid. How did the demiurge relate to the impassible God, or good, that Plato had put in charge of everything? Plotinus answered that God stands immovable at the head of a chain of created and creating emanations. The first of these emanations, intellect, contains ideas. The second, soul, contains nature. The next is the demiurge. Plato had not supplied much information about the natural world created by the demiurge's collaborators, and his thesis that we cannot know such things in principle inhibited elaboration of Timaeus's hints about polyhedra. So Neoplatonism grafted on Aristotle's Physica as its account of the visible universe created by the demigods employed by the demiurge. Another conflation assimilated the top Neoplatonic powers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.